were really pleased when Caroline took over the village shop. It had got rather run down when Bill was in charge. That was her father, lovely old soul. But there were some really strange things on the shelves in his day. Tins of tripe, dried mangoes, Himalayan rock salt. Not exactly the sort of thing you'd be looking for if you wanted to cook your Sunday lunch. But Caroline understands what we need, and she's really turned the shop around. Not that it was an entirely smooth transition, though. Quite a lot of arguments between the sisters, I've heard. Oh, yes. Kirsty, that's Caroline's younger sister, lives in the village too. She's quite a lot younger than Caroline. You did wonder about that when she was born, but you don't want to hear that, of course. Kirsty and her husband, Tom, have two gorgeous children. There's a little boy, I forget his name, but always full of smiles when you see him. And then there's a baby, rather thin and pale, but wonderful blue eyes. Perhaps it's just as well they're going to have a new GP in the village. I understand that a Dr. Crippen is about to Now, what I really wanted to talk to you about was this rather frustrating situation we find ourselves in. The future of the shop is at stake. And we've really come to rely on it for those occasions when we need some custard for the crumble or a few more courgettes because Sue is coming to supper. I've heard that Fred Pepplethwaite wants to buy Caroline out. Goodness knows where he's got the money from, but he's already bought up all the land around the shop, and now he just needs the shop in order to start developing. They say he wants to build 30 houses there. Well, I don't know how they're going to fit them all in. Would they all be able to see into each other's windows? Of course, we can object, but there's some who say it's a done deal. He's bound to have the backing of Colonel Smythe. He's the elderly bachelor, lives in the manor, you know? Sits in the front pew of St. Andrew's every Sunday. Not that it makes him any more ready to splash the cash at the church fete. Oh no, he's a miserly old sort and not very community-minded. Oh well, I must get on. John forgot to bring my Daily Telegraph this morning, so I'm going to have to go and get it myself. See you around.
Piece of junk. Oh, sorry about that. Wasn't expecting an audience. And I know what you're thinking. He's a little bit old to be a paper boy, isn't he? Well, I'm just 17. What can I tell you? I'm mature for my age. I like being a paper boy. Yeah, it's not the best job in the world, but it hurts. It's the things I see when I'm out and about on my round. You get overlooked, see, as a paper boy. It's like, if people see you every day for long enough, well, they don't really see you at all. And around here, well, there's loads of people think, I haven't got two brain cells to rub together. So why hide anything from me? I suppose that's probably why Kirsty, Caroline's sister, you know. Well, she didn't offer me any excuses when she nearly bumped into me coming out of the manor at 6 a.m. this morning. Well, I don't need to be a genius to figure out what her and that old fart Smythe have been getting up to. And the important thing is, I think, Too cold to be hanging around here chatting. I'll see you around though, alright? Hello, Caroline.
Morning again, John.
Oh, it's freezing out there this morning. Roll on summer, I say. My hands are numb. You should see the state of them since my old gloves gave out.
Well, get yourself some new ones then.
That's hardly likely. The pittance you're paying me. Actually, about that, Caroline.
Your month's pay.
Your month's pay? Ooh, I nearly forgot.
Thank you. Oh, yeah. The thing is, Caroline, well, you know how I've been doing business studies at college? Well, I made it to a lecture this week. Really interesting. All about the minimum wage. Apparently, I'm owed £5.60 an hour. But you're only paying me £4.
I've done the maths.
I've done the maths, and there's quite a lot of back pay owing to me. I reckon, well, at least £100.
Don't be daft! Being a paper boy isn't a proper job. You're lucky to get as much as you do. And if you don't like the working conditions, you can leave any time. There are plenty more teenagers in the village who would welcome a job.
Well, if you're going to take that kind of attitude, I might have to report you.
Oh, really? Who to? Who's going to take the time to listen to a spotty 17-year-old who would barely scrape through his GCSEs? That college you're at really does take in any old riffraff.
That's a bit harsh. Not me, not. Okay, Caroline. I might have some information you'd be very interested in, though. Something that'd be worth £100 of anyone's money.
Goodness me! Are we in a crime drama now? I'm sure, John, there is nothing that you could possibly know that would be worth that much. I'm sure.
Not even if it was about your sister? Something you wouldn't want the whole village to know. Something that could damage her reputation. Perhaps about her and that stuck-up lord of the manor.
What do you mean? What's she been up to? You'd better not be making this up.
I'm not, and I'll tell you. But you need to promise to pay me the money first. I want £100 up front. And I want minimum wage from now on.
I must be a fool to agree to this. If you're lying, John Bainbridge, then I shall have every penny back and there'll be no more job for you.
I'm not. Cross my heart and hope to die. You just ask Kirsty. She might be able to deny it.
Well, I haven't got £100 right now. I went to the bank yesterday, so I haven't got £100. So, what's she been up to?
I was on my way up. Oh, nice try, Caroline. You're not going to get me like that. No, I'm not giving you any more information till the money's in my hands.
Well, I don't know.
It's a deal.
It's a deal, I think. If you come back later, after lunch, I should have enough from today's takings by then.
Excellent.
All right?
I'll see you this afternoon.
Okay.
I'll get you gorgeous. And as for you, with your floppy phone, your days are numbered.
Morning, Caroline.
Oh, morning, Fred.
Have a book of first class stamps and a bottle. No, two bottles of Prosecco, please. Shop doing all right? Business good for this time of year?
Doing very nicely,
mean, just think of all those poor people in London and Birmingham with nowhere nice to live.
Really? Did he have a fall for that? Oh.
You're developing
this plot. Out of good hand.
Yes, sorry.
Out of the goodness of your heart. You're developing this plot out of the goodness of your heart.
Really,
I don't believe a word of it.
You will
make a fortune if this development goes ahead.
Come on, Caroline. You're only just saying that. I mean, you know that I need this shop and the car park to satisfy the highways agency. I mean, I'll make you a good offer, a really generous offer.
I'm not interested, Fred. This shop is my livelihood for at least the next 15 years. And this village needs its shop. What's the point of having 30 more families in the village if they've nowhere to come and buy their groceries, etc.?
How about underground? That'll see you nicely into retirement. I mean, this little place, I mean, it must be emerging money.
This little place is doing fine. You'd be surprised, Fred. If that keeps me going, you just think about how often you come down here to patronise it. I am not going to be selling my shop just so that you can make immoral amounts of money.
Look, I'm not giving up on this, Caroline. I've tried a nice approach. Just you remember that. Now, this will all come back to you. I'm going to own this shop. You just remember that. It'll be mine.
Money, Caroline.
that extravagant wedding 6 years ago when I bought you out.
But it's so much more profitable now than it was then. It's only fair. It's like you're denying me my inheritance.
Oh, that's just not true. You know, too many people, they go down the road to the co-op where everything is cheaper, special offers.
Well, you could take up Fred's offer.
How do you know about that?
Everybody knows about that. But you'd have plenty of money to live on. Then you could lend me 10 grand.
10 grand? What do you need that sort of money for?
Well, there's those new houses opposite the golf club. Some of them are part ownership ones. If we could get the deposit together, we could have one. Oh, Caroline, it would be a nice new warm home. Oh, Caroline, it would be perfect.
Oh, I'm sorry, Kirsty. There's no way I'm selling this shop. I could never lend you that sort of money. Maybe you better rely on the goodness of Colonel Smythe's heart, if that's what you're trying to do.
Oh, I don't know what you're talking about. Anyway, I can't believe that you would do this to your own sister. You always were mean with money. No wonder you never got married. Fine, then, don't help me. I'll get the money somehow, one way or another. Oh, sorry. I must get on my way. Bye.
I'm sure I know her from somewhere. Hello, anyone there?
Just coming. What can I get you?
Oh, well, nothing today, thanks. We've just moved into the village and, well, I thought I'd come and introduce myself. I'm going to be the new GP here.
Oh, that's very nice. You're going to be most welcome in our village full of pensioners. Oh, my God! It can't be!
Good gracious. Is it Caroline? Well, that's amazing.
Responsibility. How about 30 years of marriage?
Do I? And he thought I had three sons, and I've got a daughter as well. That's fantastic news.
Yes, you do. You have an unwanted daughter and an ex-girlfriend whom you abandoned when she was pregnant, and grandchildren practically living in squalor. You just swore into this village and say everything is okay. And you're pretending to be a responsible doctor.
Ah, come now. This is 2018. I'm not going to bother what happened 30 years ago. I'm sure of that.
You don't know this village. We're very traditional here. Still living in the 20th century at the moment. And I know just the person who could spread this sort of information in no time at all.
Okay, then what do you want from me?
How about a deposit for a house?
Oh, God, it must be crazy.
Oh, not for me. But for your poor, sickly grandchildren and worn-out daughter who desperately need to move out of their damp cottage here.
Yeah. You mean they live in the village too? Gracious. Hang on. That woman who bumped into me.
Yes. But everybody thinks she is my sister.
Oh, so it's not just my reputation that's on the line.
Oh, people won't care about that. I've been keeping that secret far too long. It would almost be a Look, I don't want to discuss it anymore. I want what I'm owed, or Mrs. Maple will know everything.
Oh, so comes to blackmail, does it? Do you know, Caroline, there was a time when I really did love you. But now I think I made the right decision to leave you. You're a nasty piece of work. But my daughter, well, that's a different matter. I might have to think about that a while. Give me till this afternoon and I'll let you know the answer.
Bye.
Morning, Caroline.
Morning, Todd.
A pack of 20 marbles, please.
You know what I think about your habit, Todd. I do hope you're not smoking near those darling children of yours.
I know. But it's giving up just isn't going to happen. With all the stress I'm under at the moment.
Kirsty was telling me that Olivia is sickly again. She didn't look too well herself, actually. She was totally out of sorts and had a right go at me. What's she been up to?
Oh, she's just Kirsty, looking after the children, trying to survive in that god-awful cottage. Don't mind her, it's just the stress we're both under.
Caroline, that cocktail is something for my supper. Do you have any of those lasagnas in stock?
No, I don't. That's my. I've got Thai green curry or shepherd's pie.
Shepherd's pie. Yeah.
I don't know how he's got the nerve to show his face in here.
Drop it, Tom. You get out on now and look after that dear sister of mine. There we are. Thank you.
I don't know how you can live with yourself.
You've had it easy for many years now. I'm just getting my due.
Your making money out of working class people who have no choice in where to live. Have you ever seen the state of the place? Mould through the bathroom, draught through all the windows. No wonder the children are sick all the time.
Nobody's making you stay there, Mother's, isn't it? You're welcome to leave any time.
You're inhuman. Never had to do a proper day's work in your life. Well, I'm slaving outdoors, all hours, all weather. That's still your one in the mansion.
£4.50, please.
John, is anything wrong?
No, no, nothing wrong. It's just I'm late to meet a mate. I got delayed at the shop. Caroline wanted me to help her change the light bulb. Look, I'm really sorry, Mrs. N, but I can't talk now. I've got to get home.
all right if she wasn't always suffering from a cold. I can't keep her warm in that damp cottage. I've just been to the shop to pick up some nappies, but Caroline wasn't there.
So annoying.
I've almost run out.
That's very strange. She must have been there a moment ago because John said that he'd had to help her change her light bulb.
Well, I must be going because Olivia will be screaming for her food. Yeah. Goodbye.
Okay, bye-bye. Oh, afternoon, Colonel. How are you today?
Well, very well. That's more than I can say for this village, however. All the gossip and ill will that's floating around.
Oh, really? Yes. Do you think so? I haven't found it like that. I've always loved living here and listening to everything that's going on. Have you been to the shop? Did you see Caroline?
No. I just popped in to get some stamps. She wasn't there, but I must be on my way. Cheerio, ma'am.
Okay, bye-bye. Oh, afternoon, Tom and Fred. Did you see Caroline at the shop? No one seems to have seen her.
No, I assume that she'd gone to the loo or something. I just got what I wanted and left the money on the counter.
I didn't go into the shop. I was just on my way home and met Fred as he was on the way out.
That's really strange. Are those duck eggs, Fred Heppelthwaite? You do know that Mrs. Parsley suspects it's you taking them from her pond. Tell you what, give me a couple for my baking and I won't let
you. Now, what are you talking to? You must have a troop of spies in this village. I've only got two. I'm going to have a nice Spanish omelette for my supper.
Yes, that's what you think. Well, I don't know for that.
Has anybody seen Caroline? She's not in the shop.
You're a new face around here. You must be the new GP. Hello, I'm Mrs. Maple. How do you do?
Please, won't you? Here, Crippin. Now, I must be going, so I've got to see Caroline for this afternoon.
Wait a moment. I think something's happened to Caroline. No one's seen her for ages, which is most unlike her. I think we'd better go and find her, and a medical man might come in useful.
I'll go and check the storeroom. Oh no! Dr. Crippin, come quickly! It's
terrible! Somebody phone for an ambulance, get the defibrillator straight away, please. I'll just inject her with some adrenaline. Now, Mrs. Maple, get on with it. Come with some CPR. Oh, my this defibrillator is ancient. Just say, I stand back. All right, all clear.
Thank you.
Let's start with... Oh, no, you all went to the shop after she fell from the ladder and before we found the body. Let's start with you, John. Why were you leaving the shop in such a hurry?
Okay, I admit it. I did it. I killed her. Oh, I didn't mean to. It was an accident, I swear it was. It was so dark in that storeroom. I couldn't see a thing. I found the bulb okay, but then I bumped the ladder and it was wobbling and Caroline, she was falling and screaming. And then nothing. I just knew I'd killed her. I don't want to go to prison. Oh, God, Mrs. O, what's going to happen to me?
There, there, John. It's going to be all right. But you did a bad thing, you know. If you had called an ambulance, Caroline might still be alive.
You saw Kirsty coming towards the shop and, oh God forgive me, I panicked and ran.
Oh, don't worry, John. Yes, all is not lost. I've forgotten something from my life.
Gash across the back of her head. That must have occurred when she fell off the ladder. She was lying in this great pool of blood, so she can't have died instantly. I turned her head over. There was a depressed skull fracture on her left temple region. There was a big tin of peaches lying in that pool of blood. So the only explanation is somebody went in later and struck the fatal blow.
So you see, John, that's why I don't think you were the murderer. Caroline was actually still alive when you ran out of the shop, and you didn't really have a motive.
Colonel Smythe had a motive.
How dare you, sir?
Caroline thought you and Kirsty were having an affair. You didn't want anyone to find out. You were killed to keep your so-called reputation intact.
I'll have you know that I turned that foolish wife of yours down. Yes, I admit I was a little bit frightened that gossip would get around about me. But I wouldn't kill for it. On the other hand, your wife was pretty desperate.
Nobody saw you when you were in the shop, Colonel. So you did have the opportunity, but I don't think you have the strength to have delivered the fatal blow. Now, you suggested that Kirsty had a motive.
Leave
her alone. No, wait. The Colonel has a point. Kirsty, you stood to inherit the shop, didn't you? And that does give you a motive.
Me? I couldn't kill anyone. Certainly not my own sister. Caroline would have come round and lent me the money eventually, so what was the point? I didn't need to kill her.
Mothers have been known to act very impulsively in order to protect their children. And you are very protective of Olivia and Benji. You must have been hurt and angry at being turned down by Colonel Smythe, and you were certainly desperate for money. But I don't think you would have taken a crying baby into that dark and back room to commit a murder.
She never
was
a baby,
now. So, let's see who else had a motive. Dr.
Well, I certainly didn't kill her.
You had the means, opportunity, and motive. You were the last person to leave the shop, and therefore the last person to see Caroline alive. Dead.
But hang on a minute. I just popped in for some milk. As soon as I saw Caroline wasn't in the shop there, I left immediately. That's when you saw me. Anyway, I'm new to the village. Why on earth would I want to murder her?
Ah, but Caroline wasn't a stranger to you, was she, Dr.
We did have a brief affair. But I'd no idea that Caroline lived in this village. We were both totally amazed when we bumped into each other in the shop this morning.
Just an old flame? I think you're looking very uncomfortable there, Dr. Crippen. And why do you keep on looking at Kirsty like that? Wait a minute. Kirsty, exactly how much younger than your sister were you?
Oh, Mum always said I was a surprise baby. It's 18 years.
Oh, my God! So, I think we can assume what happened. So, there's your motive, Doctor. You murdered Caroline in order to cover up a youthful indiscretion and maintain your standing as a family GP. Did she ask for something to keep it quiet?
Well, she did. Well, I wouldn't have given her anything. Well, my daughter, well, yeah, that's a different matter. It's true. She did try to blackmail me. Thank you. But I had no opportunity. I didn't even know there was a back room to the shop until you showed me.
But you gave her an injection when you were trying to deny her. Maybe that was the means of murder and not the tin of peaches. Exactly what was in that injection, Dr. Crippen? Was it adrenaline or just air?
Oh, come now, Mrs. Mabel. You saw just as well as I was. She was properly dead before I tried to revive her. Anyway, why on earth would I murder her when I just discovered she was the mother of my long-lost daughter?
Well, let's think who else had a motive. Fred Heatherthwaite, you certainly did. With Caroline dead, Kirsty was desperate for money.
Picked them up. When Caroline wasn't there, I went through to the storeroom. And there she was, laying on the floor. I assumed she was dead already. And then realised that all our troubles would be over. We would have money, a nice new home. And then she moved. I just couldn't help myself. I grabbed the tin, off the shelf and hit her with it just to be sure. There was a crackling sound, a groan, and then nothing. I dropped the tin and ran.
I'm afraid there's no escape, Tom. I telephoned the police 10 minutes ago, and they're on their way to make an arrest.